Today, we are going to talk about the behaviorist perspective of second language acquisition. First, a reminder. Traditional language teaching is not behaviorist. Actually, it is pretty much the contrary. In the previous video, we saw that traditional language teaching, the grammar translation method, was using the mother tongue, explaining the grammar, and focusing on reading the literature. In this video, you will see that behaviorist language teaching does the exact opposite. It only uses the target language, English for example, it does not explain the grammar and puts the emphasis on speech. But let's start with the beginning. For foreign language teaching, the behaviorist perspective starts with something you probably didn't think could have to do with education, and it's the Second World War. It all begins in Hawaii in December 1941. Until then, the United States have remained essentially neutral in the war, but one moment is going to change the course of this war, and it's the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor. It's going to be a traumatic episode for the Americans and is going to force them to enter the war. The reason why the bombing of Pearl Harbor was so traumatizing is that the US Army didn't see it coming. It took them completely by surprise. And that was due to one reason in particular. Very few people understood the Japanese language. And this language problem was going to be even more acute a bit later in the war, in 1944. The Allies are planning the landings of American and British troops in France, in Normandy, to liberate Europe from the Nazis. They're sure that the French population is going to support them, but there is just one little problem. The soldiers do not speak French, and the population does not speak English. You can imagine the possible consequences of this lack of comprehension in a war. So the US Army takes the decision of training a large number of soldiers to learn French. But they know the language teaching methods used in school do not work. They don't need their soldiers to be able to read Voltaire and Victor Hugo. They need them to be able to understand basic oral French and say a few things. And they need a method that would be effective and fast. They don't have 5 years. So they decide to turn to the universities to find someone who could design a new language teaching method. At the time, there is one theory dominating the faculty of psychology, and that is behaviorism. Behaviorism is a theory of learning, trying to understand how humans and animals acquire certain behaviors. Some of the most famous behaviorist psychologists are John Watson, Ivan Pavlov, and particularly B.F. Skinner. To summarize it very briefly, according to behaviorism, all behaviors are learned through conditioning of a stimulus-response reaction. These are the two key elements at the source of learning: repetition and reinforcement, which promotes memorization. But how does that translate to language teaching? Behaviorists devised a method focused on speech, repetition, and drills that I will explain in a moment. But after the war, what was called the Army method became the main behaviorist language teaching method, the audio-lingual method. How does it work exactly? Well, first, priority is given to speech. Everything is audio-lingual. Learners listen to a dialogue and then repeat orally each sentences. There is a lot of repetition of the full sentences, of the dialogues, or variations of some of the sentences. As a form of reinforcement, the audio-lingual method offers drills. Repetition drills, transformation drills, and substitution drills in particular. In transformation and substitution drills, what the students have to do is they have to change the words or transform the syntax of a sentence. For example, they receive an affirmative sentence and they have to transform it into a negative one or an interrogative one. You know, transforming a question into an affirmation or negation. Okay. Behaviorists think that mistakes generate fossilization. In other words, that the erroneous form will remain fixed in the brain. Thus, they recommend correcting all errors immediately. I recommend you watch the teaching demonstration video of the audio-lingual method to have a better idea of the whole process. Now, as you know, this is not the perfect method either. Actually, it has very strong limitations, and it started to be heavily criticized in the 1960s. You see, what happens is that the phrases that the learners practiced repeatedly in class, those sentences are very well memorized. They are even overlearned. Many adults who learned with the audio-lingual method remember somewhat absurd sentences from the dialogues, such as "John is in the kitchen" or "Your flowers are beautiful." The problem is that John is rarely in the kitchen, and the students learn these sentences as is. They were almost never able to create new sentences to express new meanings. The extreme repetition is both boring and ineffective to be able to express new meanings in new situations with the language. Behaviorism is too reductionist, and a foreign language cannot be learned the same way Pavlov trained his dog to react to a certain sound. You probably have heard of the foremost critic of the audio-lingual method. That's Noam Chomsky. He's also actually the proponent of the opposite perspective of second language acquisition theory, the innatist perspective. And this will be the subject of our next video. See you then.